gone.
Shit!
You're really gonna get it this time? He had his indicator on.
Shut up!
No! No! I'm not going on. Stay on the road!
Of course I'm going on! Shut up!
People's lives are in peril!
When Mad Max came out in 1979, apocalyptic films had been saturating the big screen for almost 20 years. Death Race 2000 came out 4 years before with the same plot of souped-up cars running over innocent pedestrians. The Omega Man, 1971, has mutated beasts as the main antagonist. Mad Max didn't have an original plot, and isn't necessarily interesting by today's standards. Regardless, with a budget of $400,000, Mad Max still earned over $100 million worldwide. This set the record into the Blair Witch Project in 1999. So, why did Mad Max perform so well? To Americans, it may be the high-velocity stunts or Mel Gibson's undeniable charisma, but the film had a larger appeal to the continent of Australia. Mad Max was a key movie for Australian cinema. Even after critics thought a film about the lowest depths of humanity wouldn't attract audiences, Mad Max ended up inspiring people like James Cameron to write Terminator. Mad Max has been represented in countless types of media, like TV shows, animated movies, and even video games. Mad Max is only one movie from the Australian New Wave era. Defining the Australian New Wave can be a little tricky, as it was not a development of new editing techniques like the Soviets, or styles of storytelling like the French. However, it was a collection of films with similar themes and the purpose of promoting Australia's cultural development. During the 1960s, Australia's film industry had come to a complete halt. In an attempt to show the world their true culture, the government founded the Australian Film, Television, and Radio School in 1968. Along with heavy funding, the government was actually the kickstart of the Australian New Wave. Between 1970 and 1985, the country produced over 400 films. This is more films than had ever been produced in the country's prior history. The films were famously low budget, which allowed the directors to show the true dirt and grime of the Australian outback. Many movies focused on the Aboriginal people and the hardships that come with the environment. This is the center of Nicholas Roeg's Walkabout, which focused on two white children who became stranded in the outback and received help from an Aboriginal boy. The film explores Aboriginal rituals and lifestyles as the boy has to help two children navigate the dangerous terrain. The Australian New Wave did not start to affect the rest of the world until Mad Max became a hit internationally. While the appeal of futuristic racing helped popularity in America, Mad Max received praise domestically for representing the history of Australia. After the start of the October War of 1973, the entire world felt effects in gas prices rising when Saudi Arabia cut off all oil exports. This is especially prevalent in Australia, with gas prices almost quadrupling. Director George Miller got inspiration for Mad Max when he experienced people degrade into animal violence as they fought over access to gas pumps. While this historical nod was missed by most Americans, the locals of Australia got the idea. While Mad Max is a very successful film in the United States, Australia did not start to feel the real benefits of the new wave until 1986 when Peter Frampton's Crocodile Dundee was released. Before the 1980s, most of the developed world still saw Australia as the land full of crooks and criminals. Crocodile Dundee single-handedly showed the planet what Australia really was. The film showed beautiful places like Kakadu National Park and Jim Jim Falls. Fairman not only depicted the country's natural beauty, but also people's friendly nature. Paul Hogan plays Michael Dundee, the Australian bushman who has to show a New York journalist around the outback before following her back to the United States for his first trip to the big city. Hogan, or Hogs as the Americans started to call him, used his laid-back, adventurous personality to become Australia's new icon. Hogan normalized terms like shrimp on the barbie and wonder down under, which to this day Americans associate with Australia.
Better fill the icebox, then fire up the barbie.
With a $7 million budget, Crocodile Dundee brought in more than $300 million in the box office. 2 years later, the success was repeated with Crocodile Dundee 2, bringing in almost $250 million. In 1988, the New York Times reported that Fairman and Hogan had accidentally filmed the best destination advertisement ever created. The timing of Crocodile Dundee's release was also vital. It was released during a time in the United States when airfares were dropping and interest in tourism was growing. Americans wanted to experience the beauty of the land down under after seeing the landscape in Crocodile Dundee. Compared to the 1980s, Australia's tourism infrastructure boomed in the 90s, with their income more than doubling. Due to the surprising results from Crocodile Dundee and Mad Max, 25 to 30% of funding for every Australian feature film still comes from their government to this day. Although Australia is the same size geographically as the United States, population-wise, Australia has a measly 15 million people compared to the United States' 315 million. In other words, the Australian audience heavily depends on the state's reviews. Being one of the largest media consumers, it is extremely important for Australian films to gain American exposure. One appeal was the similar language. Americans tend to be hesitant about watching foreign films in other languages. This is a problem for the French and the Russian filmmakers, as it is difficult to gain American attention. However, Australian films are exclusively in English, albeit with an accent most Americans find entertaining. The United States is also especially interested in the theme of taming the wilderness. Australian New Wave films often share these similarities with American Westerns. All throughout America's cinema history, Westerns have been hits, some of the most notable films being The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly, El Dorado, and The Magnificent Seven. Westerns became popular after the World Wars, with John Wayne becoming the staple image of a rugged American that is self-reliant and manly. There was always a classic depiction of good and evil. Australian filmmakers saw the repeated themes in American hits and used those with a down-under twist. Crocodile Dundee does this seamlessly by showing the gritty man versus nature while still carrying Australia's tropes of beaten landscapes and native cultures. An interesting entry in the Australian New Wave is Jane Campion's 2021 The Power of the Dog. Campion uses her New Zealand heritage to spin a classic Western on its head. The Power of the Dog is about brothers Phil and George Burbank and their life on a Montana ranch. Benedict Cumberbatch's character is the dominant of the pair and follows the classic tropes of being the head honcho cowboy. However, Cumberbatch's stereotypical heroic masculinity is tested by Campion. This film explores the negativity of too much masculinity, which directly contradicts the classic Western. Another aspect that makes The Power of the Dog stick out is the scenery. Jane Campion used her native landscapes of New Zealand to recreate the vastness of rural Montana. She used the new wave approach of showing off the untouched nature of Oceania, regardless of the setting being placed in the United States. Originally winning an Oscar in 1994 for her screenwriting of The Piano, Campion also won Best Director for The Power of the Dog. This has made her the second woman to win Best Director and the first woman to be nominated twice. The Australian New Wave has given America some of their greatest movies. It inspired films such as Star Wars, Terminator, and Mad Max Fury Road. Some of Hollywood's biggest names got their career started because of the Australian New Wave. Jurassic Park wouldn't have Sam Neill, Braveheart wouldn't have Mel Gibson, iconic roles like Margot Robbie's Harley Quinn and Hugh Jackman's Wolverine would be forever changed. Chris Hemsworth, who is known for his role as Marvel's Thor, is not only the highest paid actor from Australia, but is also one of the highest paid actors in the world. Hemsworth got his start from acting as a kid in Australian TV shows and commercials. Not only has the Australian New Wave resulted in some of the most notable films in history, but it is also single-handedly responsible for reigniting Australia's tourism industry and making it one of the most visited destinations in the world.
And there's plenty of shrimps on the barbie.